Getting started. It's 11:01, so I think we should start, Martin. Do you agree? And we have 59 participants. So welcome everybody to our mini symposium, Boosting Performance with High-End Interactive Gait Rehabilitation Technology. My name is Noel Keizers, and this week I will be appointed as a professor at the Radboud University, but I'm also a senior researcher at the Senatechniek. And I will be chairing this session together with Maarten Prins, and he will take over now.
Thank you, Noel. Good morning. My name is Maarten Prins. I'm chair of the HyGrid User Group and scientific coordinator at the Military Rehabilitation Center. Before I introduce the first speaker, I will quickly cover the background of our group. HyGrid is an acronym for High-End Gait Rehabilitation Interactive Technology. And in the Netherlands and Belgium, the density of these types of systems is exceptionally high. And in 2013, we started to collaborate to learn from each other's failures and successes in clinic and researches. And of course, with at the pinnacle of our success, a workshop at the Dutch Congress of Rehabilitation Medicine. The systems we use all contain instrumented treadmills with a large screen in front on which a virtual environment can be projected. And when a patient is on the system will measure the forces exerted on the treadmill, and infrared cameras that you see here around the platform can track the movements of the patient. The system can directly respond to this incoming data, for instance, by imposing a trip perturbation by briefly stopping the treadmill exactly at heel strike of the left or right foot. But based on the same principles, the system can be used to play serious games that are controlled by bodily movements. The system you see on this slide is the GRIL system, which is used in most presentations of today, but you will also encounter a Karen system. And the main difference between these systems is that the treadmill of the Karen system is on top of a 6 degree of freedom motion base that can shift and rotate the treadmill in all possible directions, whereas the motion base of the GRIL has fewer degrees of freedom. The two systems we will be talking about today are produced by the same Dutch company. And as in any advanced technology, you could argue that both the company and the customers are dependent on each other for success. But besides that, the HyGrid user group has no financial or non-financial dependency from MoTeC. One general notice, please note that the session will be recorded and shared afterwards. All speakers have been informed and consent. Now we have five speakers today, so Anke, you can get your presentation ready. Anke is our first and only Belgian speaker of today. Anke is postdoctoral researcher at the University and University Hospital of Ghent. Anke, if your presentation is ready, good luck. The floor is yours.
Okay, thank you, Maarten. I hope you can hear me all well. So I will present today how we use our GRIL system in the Ghent University Hospital for full body movement analysis of stroke patients. So I have no conflicts of interest to declare. And I just explain how we started our GRIL system in Ghent in 2019. The hospital gave us the opportunity to start SmartSpace, which is a platform that brings technology closer to the healthcare professionals and, of course, to our patients. The SmartSpace aims on many different targets, but one of them is starting our own movement analysis lab in the virtual environment, and therefore we have installed the Grail system, as Maarten just explained. It has several opportunities, and one of them is to use a self-paced mode, so the patient can control his own walking speed while walking on the treadmill. We use the Grail system in the clinic to train and assess balance and gait, and a lot of our patients in the rehabilitation center where the Grail is installed are patients after stroke, and we wondered whether there was a difference in their way of walking when using the self-paced mode of the Grail system, because a lot of research in stroke patients has been done on treadmills, but in most cases it was a fixed speed treadmill. So we started the cross-sectional design study with three research questions. First of all, we wanted to know if there was a difference in spatiotemporal parameters between overground walking and self-paced walking on the Grail system. We wanted to explore the differences in spatiotemporal parameters, but also kinematics and kinetics between fixed speed and self-paced walking on the Grail. And we used a full body marker set to collect also pilot data to gain more insight in the upper limb during walking in our stroke patients. So we recruited 25 stroke patients who could walk independently for 6 minutes or for at least 6 minutes. And they were on average 53 years old and 41 months post-stroke. According to the Fugl-Meyer assessment, they showed a mild impairment of the lower limb and a moderate to mild impairment of the upper limb. And they expressed moderate concerns about risk of falling in daily life situations. All patients walked on the gait right to collect spatiotemporal parameters of overground walking, and on the Grail system to collect spatiotemporal parameters, but also kinematics and kinetics, both in the fixed speed condition and in the self-paced condition. Now, when comparing the results of overground walking and self-paced walking on the treadmill, we noticed that persons after stroke tend to walk slower on the treadmill compared to overground. This has been something that has been described on fixed speed treadmills also, but we also find it for the self-paced treadmill. Accordingly, the patients also showed a shorter step length, a longer double support phase, and a shorter single support phase. And we think it has to do with the fact that stroke patients have more difficulties to control their postural control when walking on a moving surface like the treadmill. Earlier research suggested that stroke patients could increase their symmetry of walking when walking on the treadmill, but in our study we could not find any differences in variability or symmetry measures when comparing the overground condition to the self-paced treadmill condition. When comparing the fixed speed and the self-paced treadmill condition to each other, we also saw a slower walking velocity in the fixed speed condition compared to the self-paced condition, and accordingly, again, a lower cadence, shorter step lengths, a longer double support phase, and a shorter single support phase. And to explain this difference, we think when walking on a self-paced treadmill, stroke patients feel more confident to increase their walking speed because they have this feeling of control about this walking speed, and they know they can decrease the walking speed again if necessary. We also looked at kinematics and kinetics and used SVM statistics to compare the graphs for each joint during the gait cycle. And although differences could be detected in different joints, both on the paretic and non-paretic side, the differences were very small, smaller than 3 degrees for the kinematics and smaller than 0.1 newton meter per kilogram for the kinetics. So we think these differences were not clinically relevant. When looking at the upper limb results, we could detect two different groups of movement in the shoulder flexion extension direction. So one group shows a normal pattern of flexion extension during walking in the shoulder, and the other group shows a deviating pattern of flexion extension in the shoulder. And when looking to the elbow flexion degrees of both groups, we noticed that the group with the deviating shoulder flexion extension pattern also showed more elbow flexion during walking. We compared the walking velocity between those two groups because Early research indicated that the arm swing depends on the walking velocity. However, we could not detect any differences between those two groups for walking velocity. Other factors that might be that might contribute to the arm swing of stroke patients seem to be the upper limb and the lower limb recovery and the spasticity of shoulder internal rotators, because we could find significant differences between those groups with a lower recovery level for the upper and lower limb in the group with the deviating shoulder pattern, and they also showed more internal rotation spasticity of the shoulder muscles. So to summarize, we want to notice that when using self-paced treadmills for assessing stroke patients, you have to take into account the differences in walking speed, and we have noticed that for our group, the velocity of the self-paced mode was most related to the velocity of the overground walking. Other differences that were detected do not have to be taken into account because they were too small to be clinically relevant. And we need to do some more research on larger sample sizes to define subgroups of upper limb movements during walking and potentially contributing factors of the upper limb during walking.
Thank you, Anke. Please, if you have any questions, put them in the chat and we can answer them. But maybe to start a question, Anke, is related to the patient group. Had they any experience on treadmill walking before they did this experiment? Or was this the first time that they walked on the treadmill?
Some of them did some treadmill walking in their rehabilitation sessions, but we didn't really question it to the patients, but all patients received a practice session of at least 6 minutes to get used to the treadmill walking before we started recording the data of this study.
And if there are no other questions, and maybe another question, so how did you test the overground? Was it in a 3D gait lab, or was it just walking for a longer distance?
Yeah, we tested it walking on the gait ride, and where we could collect only spatial temporal parameters. But we did have the patients walking several times on the gait ride to have a really realistic data about their spatial temporal parameters and walking velocity.
Okay, thank you. Are there no questions? Oh, Maarten has a question.
Please, yes, Maarten. I can do it using my microphone. So you found a difference in walking velocity between the treadmill and overground, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any idea to what extent the significant differences in kinematics and kinetics could be the result of that speed difference? In other words, would you expect to have found differences in kinematics and kinetics if they would have walked at the same velocity on the treadmill when you compare the treadmill to overground?
Now, the mean difference in walking speed between the fixed speed and the self-paced condition is 0.09 meter per second. So it is not really a huge difference. So maybe because we also find small differences in kinematics, they might be related to the walking speed. But I think to have more insight in this information, we need a bigger group, because I expect, based on a little bit of experience in the clinic, that it is especially the patients who have more difficulties with dynamic balance that have a bigger difference in walking speed between fixed speed and self-paced. But we couldn't do any subgroup analysis in this study because there were only 25 participants.
Okay, thank you. Then we move up a little bit north to Breda, and from Breda, our next speaker is Ilona de Roy. Important also to note, she is researcher at Revant, but she will defend her PhD thesis at December 7th, so give her good luck for that, of course. But first of all, she will present something probably from her PhD thesis at this symposium. Ilona.
Thank you, Noel, and hello, everyone. Today, I would like to tell you about my PhD thesis called Walking in Relation to Participation After Stroke is Fragility to Training of Added Value. I have no disclosures. The thesis consists of two parts. In the first part, walking was explored in relation to participation. And this part investigates the relation between walking ability and the experienced restrictions in daily life. In the second part, we investigated the added value of virtual reality training for stroke rehabilitation. And today I want to tell you about what we learned on the use of virtual reality training to improve walking and participation after stroke. We investigated virtual reality training using four different study designs and in different subgroups of people after stroke. First, we performed a systematic literature review. The aim of this study was to investigate the effect of virtual reality balance or gait training in comparison with a non-virtual reality balance or gait training. This study included people within varying phases of the stroke and also various VR interventions. Then we performed an effect study, a randomized controlled trial in community living people within the first 6 months of the stroke. And the aim of this study was to study the effect of virtual reality gait training on participation. Then a pilot study was set up in people within the first 12 weeks after stroke who are following inpatient rehabilitation. And this study investigated the feasibility and effectiveness of balance and gait training. And last, we investigated the patient experiences using semi-structured interviews. In the last 5 years, many systematic reviews have been performed regarding the effects of VR training, also for balance and gait training. And regarding balance, the most recent review showed that VR in combination with conventional therapy can be more effective than conventional therapy alone. And also for walking ability, the most recent three reviews showed that VR training is more effective for improving spatiotemporal gait parameters than training without VR. And also our own review from 2016 shows that virtual reality gait training can be more effective than a non-virtual reality gait training. However, these systematic reviews focus on functional outcome measures, and little is known about whether these improvements translate to daily life. Therefore, we performed an effect study that had participation as the primary outcome measure. And in the reviews, various different VR interventions were used, but we chose to perform the VR training with the grill. We expected that VR training with the grill could give opportunities to train an advanced level of walking ability, and also multiple motor learning principles could be applied. But which elements of the training can make the training have added value? To start with, people can train on a very high intensity on the treadmill. Also, perturbations can be given. The treadmill can move sideways and the two belts can accelerate or decelerate separately. In addition, obstacles can be projected on the treadmill surface about which a patient has to step over. The therapist can also add dual tasks during walking, both motor or cognitive dual tasks. And using the motion capture system, real-time feedback can be given about the movement execution, which can increase the learning rate. The virtual environment contains also a lot of game elements, which can increase the motivation of patients and which makes you feel immersed within the virtual environment. And lastly, people wear a safety harness, which makes it possible to train on a maximal level. In the VIRTA study, we compared virtual reality gait training on the grill with a non-virtual reality gait training. We included 52 people in the first 6 months after stroke. They were all community living and could walk without support of others. And both interventions were followed for 6 weeks, two times per week, 30 minutes. And there were three assessments, one at baseline, one at post-intervention, and one after 3 months of follow-up. The primary outcome measure of the study was participation, as measured with the user peer restriction scale. And this figure shows the effects of both training interventions. The virtual reality training group improved 3.1 points per month on the user peer restriction scale. and the non-virtual reality gait training improved 1.9 points. The additional improvement for the virtual reality gait training group was, however, not statistically significant. So we could not say that the virtual reality gait training was more effective than the non-virtual reality gait training. The Virtual study focused on people who had community living and could walk independently. We also performed a pilot study, which was focused on people early after stroke who could not walk independently and followed inpatient rehabilitation. And also in this group of people, the VR training appeared safe and feasible. There were little adverse events and the training compliance was very high. And this group also improved in their balance and walking ability. So VR training on the grill seemed also suitable for people with more severe impairments after stroke. Then we also asked the patients how they experienced the virtual reality gait training. People liked the safe training environment, the variation in exercises and the game elements. And they experienced the greatest advantage of the training, the opportunities to train dual task, reaction time, obstacle avoidance, and reactive balance. In people who could walk independently, they experienced most improvements when walking on irregular terrain, when walking in busy environments, or when performing joint tasks during walking. And more important, most people experienced that their self-confidence improved during walking because of the virtual reality gait training. Our study showed that VR training is feasible and can be positively experienced by people after stroke. The training seems suitable for a wide range of people after stroke. Beneficial effects for balance and spatiotemporal gait parameters were found in systematic reviews. However, our own effect study could not show that virtual reality is more effective than a non-virtual reality gait training. Yet, we suggest to add VR training to the range of existing gait interventions. VR training can be especially of added value when it is used to train specific aspects of walking ability, like perturbation training or dual task training. And future research could help to give more insight in the training content and characterize the people for whom virtual reality training can best be considered. When VR is incorporated in the range of the existing rehabilitation interventions, it can be carefully considered based on the goals, wishes, and abilities of the patients. Thank you for listening. And if you are interested in my PhD thesis, then please let me know. I can send you the PDF or a printed copy.
Thank you, Ilona, for your talk. Important work. And I think it was a good experience before your defense later this year. Again, if you have any questions, please put them in the chat and I'll ask them to Ilona. First of all, I have a question. As soon as you start doing research, you notice how difficult it is to capture individual patients into a paper where you describe 30, 40, 50, 60 patients. Were you present at the training interventions and can you give a bit of insight about maybe individual success stories or individuals that didn't like the training so much? How did that go?
Well, I was not present at the training intervention because it was a randomized controlled trial and I performed all the assessments. So I didn't knew which intervention people followed. But I think it differs per patients which aspect of the training they like most. Some people like the dual task training, some the perturbation, or learned most from the from real-time feedback they received. There is a lot of variation in which elements of the training are experienced most positively by the patients, I think.
Okay, but you were present at the measurements?
Yes.
Do you have the feeling your measurements sufficiently captured the performance of your patient, or would you have added or removed some assessments if you could do the study over?
That's a good question. I think it was very difficult to measure the high or an advanced level of walking ability. We performed several tests for walking ability, like the 6-minute walking test or the mini best test. But I'm not sure if they capture really the high level of walking ability that is necessary in daily life. So okay. Yeah, there might be other measures, but I have no suggestion for which one that it can better capture the improvements.
Okay, thank you. There's a question from Marije Vos van der Hulst. She asked, maybe I missed it, but did you measure balance outcome measures in the RCT study? And if yes, which one did you use?
Yes, we also measure balance. We used the time up and go test and the mini best test.
And what were the results?
For those tests, both groups improved, the virtual reality gait training group and the non-virtual reality gait training group.
Without a significant group type interaction effect. Yeah, okay, thanks. Yuan.
Yeah, my question is a bit in line with the question from Maarten. Did you see a specific subgroup that is more successful? So did you... Do you have knowledge about a subgroup with a certain effect on your outcome variables?
Yeah, I think that will be very interesting for future research to determine which subgroup of people benefits most from virtual reality gait training. What we heard a lot back from the patients was that they improved their confidence during walking. So it seems that the safe environment and the high level of challenge together can induce some improvements, but okay. I think future research would be necessary.
Okay, thanks, Ilona.
Thank you for your talk, Ilona. I see that there is one open question from Sven in the chat, and maybe others will follow. I want to ask you if you could answer it in the chat, but because of time constraints, I'm going to introduce the next speaker, which is Eline Zwijgers from the Maartens Kliniek. Eline will tell us a bit about her research on walking adaptability. Eline, good luck. The floor is yours.
Yes, thank you, Maarten, for the introduction. Today, I'm going to give a presentation about a study we are currently working on. And it's about gait training for incomplete spinal cord injury, which one is better. So I have no disclosure to mention. And then something about the background. So approximately 60% of people with a spinal cord injury suffer from an incomplete lesion. And many of these patients encounter deficits at or below the lesion, such as muscle weakness, spasticity, or an impaired motor coordination. And this often leads to an impaired balance and walking capacity. And this in turn leads to a reduced functional ambulation and participation. And there are many interventions that help spinal cord injury patients to improve balance and walking capacity. And one which is a promising intervention is walking adaptability training. In 2016, we did a study on the effects of walking adaptability training on the GRAIL in patients with an incomplete spinal cord injury in the Sint Maartens Kliniek. And we found really promising results on the improvement of balance and walking capacity. After 6 weeks of GRAIL training, the incomplete spinal cord injury patients improved walking speed, stride length, and gait stability. And the patients also felt more confident about their balance after the six weeks GRAIL training. So we found really promising results, but we don't know if this walking adaptability training is superior over the conventional interventions. So the aim of this study is to compare the walking adaptability training given on the GRAIL with the conventional endurance and resistance training. And we are comparing both interventions on four main pillars, which are walking capacity, functional ambulation, balance, confidence, and participation. And I will come back later to these four pillars and how we measure them. But first, a little bit about the training or the interventions. Both interventions are given 2 times a week, and each session is about 60 minutes. And the total duration of the interventions is 6 weeks. The participants that follow the walking adaptability training train on the grill, and they will do several applications during one session. And the participants in the endurance and resistance training walk for approximately 20 minutes on the treadmill, and then they will train 40 minutes on the fitness equipment. Then something about the study design. We do a randomized controlled trial, and we perform the study in 2 centers, the Sint Maartenskliniek and the University Medical Center in Groningen. So it's a multi-center trial, and the goal is to eventually include 40 participants. Well, what participants do we include? The participants should have an incomplete spinal cord injury with a classification of C or D, meaning that the lesion is incomplete. And they should be 6 months post-injury to make sure that they are in a chronic phase of the injury. And the walking speed has to be between 0.3 and 1 meters per second. And then a little bit more into detail about the study design. So directly after inclusion, the participants are randomized over the 2 interventions, and then pre-assessment is done, is performed. Then 6 weeks of intervention follow. So the participants will follow either the walking adaptability training on the grill or the conventional endurance and resistance training. And then directly after the 6 weeks of intervention, we will do a post-assessment. Then 6 weeks of no intervention follow, and then we do a follow-up measurement to see if the results are still there after 6 weeks of no intervention. So what do we measure during the pre, post, and follow-up assessments? Our primary outcome measure is the walking speed, and we measure this during a 2-minute walk test, and we ask the participants to walk as fast as possible over ground, and we assess this walking speed during the pre, post, and follow-up assessment. Then we have 3 secondary outcome measures, and we assess them during the pre and follow-up assessment, so not during the post assessment. And the first one is the SCIFAP, which stands for Spinal Cord Injury Functional Ambulation Profile, it is related to the functional ambulation of the participants. And during this SCIFAP assessment, we ask the participants to do 7 daily tasks or to perform 7 daily tasks. The second secondary outcome measure is the ABC scale, which stands for Activity Specific Balance Confidence Scale. And it is a questionnaire consisting of 16 questions about the balance confidence of the participants. And the last one is the User P, which is a scale for evaluation of rehabilitation and participation, and it's also a questionnaire containing 32 questions about work, sports, and leisure time, and is related to the participation of the participants. Then I would like to move on to the results. The results are preliminary because, as I said, the goal is to include 40 patients or participants in total, and at this moment we have 20 participants that completely finished the study. So the results are based on these first 20 participants. And I would like to start with the primary outcome measure, which is walking speed, related to walking capacity. And I first show you the walking speed of the walking adaptability group measured during the pre, post, and follow-up assessment. And as you can see, the walking speed is slightly increasing over time. And the same is happening for the endurance and resistance group. Again, the walking speed is slightly increasing over time. We did a mixed ANOVA on this data, and the ANOVA showed no significant interaction effect, which means that the type of intervention did not have a different effect on the difference in walking speed over time. But we did see that both interventions increased walking speed, and post-hoc analysis showed that the walking speed during the follow-up assessment was significantly higher compared to the pre-assessment. Then moving on to the secondary outcome measures, the first one is the SkiFOB score. Good to mention that a lower SkiFOB score means that you have a better level of functional ambulation. And both interventions showed an improvement of the SkiFOB score over time, a significant improvement, but there was no difference between the interventions, so both equally improved functional ambulation. Then we have the ABC score, which says something about the balance confidence of the participants, but we do not see any interaction or time effects happening in the ABC score. And the same is true for the user P score, which is about the participation of the participant. And again, no interaction or time effects were found. And that brings me to the preliminary conclusion of this study. At this point, we see that no training type is superior to the other, but we do see that both improve walking capacity and functional ambulation after 6 weeks of intervention. And with that, I would like to conclude my presentation. And if you have any questions, please let me know in the chat or send me an email. Thank you.
Thank you. I don't know if I can see all the questions in the chat because I saw some questions, but they just disappeared for me. And I don't think it's a good idea that I ask you questions because I'm the supervisor of you. So, Maarten, maybe you can see questions because my last one is from Marije, and I have seen several other remarks in the chat.
I have the same issue, so I'll type in a test. I don't know if you see that.
No, I see the test. Okay. Probably yeah, no questions, but then I might have one question for Eline then, first of all, and then there might appear some questions. It's related to how did the participants experience the different kind of trainings? Did they prefer, for example, the grill training above the endurance or strength training? Can you comment on that?
Yeah, so we did ask after both interventions what they thought about the interventions. And there, I don't think there is a specific preference. It depends per participant what they prefer. So one patient said, I really prefer the grill training, but the other one said the endurance and resistance training is really nice. So I don't think there is this like a preference in intervention at this point.
Why did you use gait speed as a primary outcome? It was a bit surprising to me because your aim when training gait adaptability is not to increase walking speed per se, but to increase the adaptability of the gait pattern, that someone can adapt to an irregular surface or an incoming banana peel, for instance. Which outcome does capture that enhanced gait adaptability best, do you think?
I think the outcome that captures that the best is the SkiFOB, so the functional ambulation profile. But since the endurance and resistance training is not about walking adaptability, we wanted to have one outcome measure that is like we can use for both interventions. So that is why we chose walking speed as primary outcome and the SkiFOB as secondary.
Okay. If there are no other questions, then we move on.
There is another question in the chat from Sven. I don't know if you can see it, Noel.
Oh yeah, but one, did the participant, as in the study of Ilona, get more self-confident with the grill? Did you see typical characteristics? Maybe Eline can answer that for the incomplete spinal cord injury, and Ilona can answer that for the stroke patients.
Yeah, so we did measure the balance confidence of the participants directly after after the interventions, but we did not see an increase in confidence for both interventions, so not for the grill intervention and not for the endurance and resistance intervention. So the balance confidence did not increase, but we did not ask about self-confidence in general to the patients.
Ilona, can you respond?
My microphone was off. We measured self-confidence with the false efficacy scale international. In that scale, we saw an improvement for both groups. The added value regarding these self-confidence was mainly from the interviews. The patients mentioned that in the interviews, but we did not see the difference in the false efficacy scale.
Okay, thank you. Then we move on to this next speaker, which is Juha Heijmans. He's an associate professor at the Department of Rehabilitation Medicine in Groningen. And I'm personally very interested in his next talk because I'm always suffering from running injuries too. So I hope Juha has the answer to have not that problem anymore in the future. Juha, it's yours.
All right, thank you, Noel. So high expectances on this talk. So we moved to a little bit higher speed now. So we did some studies on gait retraining and running related injuries. I have no conflict of interest. So if we look at running related injuries, we know that there is a huge complex web of factors that interact and that may cause running-related injuries. And today I will focus on biomechanics and then specifically on the kinematic part. So if we look at an quite old scheme where we look at the sequence of prevention, first we have to establish what problem there is. And then we have to establish the etiology of that problem, introduce a preventive measure, and then remeasure the effectiveness. And in this scheme, we wanted to make a few small steps. So the first steps were was a meta-analysis on what kinematic risk factors are there for all kinds of tendinopathies and running-related injuries. And we found that peak rear foot eversion has a strong relation with Achilles tendinopathy, with iliotibial band syndrome, also with plantar fasciitis, patellar tendinopathy, and also posterior tibialis tendinopathy. So there is quite a large range of tendinopathies with a relation with peak rear foot eversion. It is then, of course, important to understand, to know that most of these studies are performed in patient groups, so we don't know if this peak rear foot eversion is the cause or the effect. It's important to take that into consideration. So what is peak rear foot eversion? It's the angle measured between the calcaneus and the tibia, and it's often used as a synonym for pro and supination, but in fact, this is not correct. So in an eversion, we can call a fundamental movement. It's a movement that we measure in the lab, in the frontal plane. And in biomechanics, we always try to measure our kinematics in these planes. But pro and supination is actually more the applied movement, the anatomical movement, and where pronation is consisted of eversion, adduction and dorsiflexion, and supination is the opposite. So I tell you this for two reasons. One is that it's important to make this distinction, and two, that we can use this applied movement to make changes in this rear foot eversion. Okay, so to change rear foot eversion, there are different types of interventions possible. So the first could be orthotics, and literature has proven some effect of inlays and specific shoes. In literature also, some effects of taping are mentioned, and we wanted to see the effect of gait training, gait retraining, where we use real-time feedback on the grip. And in this gait retraining, we used a few different interventions. And foot progression angle was one of them. So as we have seen, is that you if you change your foot into in or eversion, you can also, internal or external rotation, as you can see with a toe in and a toe out foot progression angle, this has a effect on eversion. So if you abduct your feet, you will also see eversion. At least that's the theory. You could also change the position of your center of pressure. By changing it more to the lateral side, we might find more inversion. And if you change it more to the medial side, we might find some eversion. Of course, we could have also given real-time feedback on the variable itself. But we found out that it was very hard for participants to understand that feedback. And also, it was hard to measure it in real time, as it's not part of the human body model that we use and of which we can use the output in real time on the grill. So what we did, we had healthy participants and we asked them to run on the grill. We measured their normal foot progression angle, and then we gave feedback on running with 5 degrees additional in toe out direction and in toe in direction. So on the screen, you see this circle with the green triangle, and the participant was asked to keep the red line inside the green triangle. And then the green triangle depicted the 5 degrees toe out or toe in, depending on which intervention we were doing. The other intervention which we did was to ask persons verbally to run more on their lateral or medial side of the foot. While we performed the foot progression angle feedback, because usually if you ask somebody to run on their lateral side of the foot, they will change their foot progression angle into toe in. So we wanted to measure the separate effect of a change in center of pressure. And this one also, we decided to do it in this way because it is hard to understand for a person to really understand the feedback on the center of pressure. And it's also really hard to measure it in real time, as we had to change the coordinate system towards a foot coordinate system in real time. So we had healthy participants running at 8 kilometers an hour. We used human body model, and we had to add the markers, additional markers on the foot to be able to measure all our outcome variables. So we also had to adopt the shoes, and we did everything in one session. So in fact, if we asked persons to change their foot progression angle, they did accordingly. That can be seen in the left graph. And on the right graph, we also see an effect on rear foot eversion. And in fact, we saw an effect of about 2 degrees into the inversion direction compared to normal. And if you compare toe in and toe out, the difference was 3.5 degrees. We found a very similar effect on the change in center of pressure. And we tested this both with peak values and with SPM. And there we saw also an effect of lateral COP versus normal of about 3 degrees and medial versus lateral of about 6 degrees. So we did see these positive effects. It is important to understand that, of course, we cannot do all these things in the lab. So we hope that with these effects, we provide input to future studies outside the lab. And we need, but we can use the lab for individualization. Of course, we can also use different equipment outside the lab. So what I showed you today is that we made some steps in the sequence of prevention, that we really have to introduce preventive measures to be able to see the future effects. And with that, I'd like to end this talk.
Thank you, Juha, for your interesting talk. Because I want to give the last speaker enough time to finish her her talk, I'm quickly going to introduce Marissa Gerards from Maastricht University Medical Center, where they have a Caren system installed. Please, if you have any questions for Juha, ask them in the chat. Marissa, good luck. The floor is yours.
Yeah, thank you, Maarten, for the introduction. Today, I would like to present the short-term results of our RCT in which we use the Caren system. I have no conflict of interest to declare. And as we know from the literature, balance training can reduce falls and improve balance control in older adults. In recent years, there's been an increasing interest in a new form of balance training, perturbation-based balance training, or in short, PBT. PBT aims to improve balance recovery reactions by repeatedly exposing participants to destabilizing perturbations in a safe and controlled environment. As approximately 60% of falls in older adults happen due to slips and trips during walking, PBT may be a more task-specific alternative to traditional balance training. So far, studies have shown that PBT can effectively reduce daily life falls and falls in the lab, and improve balance recovery from perturbations during various activities of daily living. A few studies have shown that PBT may even have the potential to be effective with a low training dose. For example, one study found a 50% reduction in daily life falls in older adults in a year after a single training session of 24 perturbations. So the results of PBT are promising, but there are still some challenges. First, there are many types of perturbations that can be applied, and this can be done in a number of ways. For example, perturbations can be applied manually by a therapist, by having participants stand or walk on a movable platform, or with an instrumented treadmill. There are pros and cons for each of these methods. And second, how do we progress training difficulty to reach perturbations of a high enough intensity to be effective, while making sure that the training is still acceptable to the participants? Because PBT is still relatively new, more research is needed to optimize training protocols. We performed a mixed methods RCT to evaluate the effects of PBT versus usual care on balance control, fear of falling, and daily life in older adults. These were all community-dwelling older adults with an increased fall risk based on a recent fall incident. We also evaluated the acceptability of the PBT protocol through semi-structured interviews. And usual care in this setting was referral to a physical therapist. In the presentation today, I will highlight our short-term outcomes on balance control. We measured balance control. This was done by a blinded outcome assessor with the mini best test. This is a clinical balance test that consists of 16 tasks over 4 domains. The domains include proactive balance control, reactive balance control, sensory orientation, and dynamic gait. And the maximum score that can be achieved is 28 points. Balance control was measured at baseline and after 4 weeks. In the 3 weeks in between, the PBT group received 3 30-minute sessions of PBT on the Caren system. Each training session had 3 parts. We included gait adaptability, perturbation training during standing, and during walking. During the perturbation training part, participants stood on the treadmill or walked at their preferred speed while various perturbations were applied. These could be unilateral treadmill belt accelerations or decelerations, or movements of the platform in any direction. We chose to include a range of perturbation types and directions to facilitate transfer of training adaptations to daily life, where falls can also occur in all kinds of conditions. And because anxiety during training can be an issue with PBT, we designed our protocol to be progressive and personalized for each participant. We started with low magnitude perturbations and asked participants to rate how challenging they found the perturbations on a scale from 0 to 10, which we then used to guide training progression. And next, I'll try to show you 2 very short videos to give you an impression of what perturbations could look like in this training. Yeah. hope you can see the video. So this is a sudden deceleration of the left treadmill belt. So it's just one example. I'll repeat it for you. And then another option is a sudden acceleration of the right treadmill belt. And you can see the reaction the participant has to recover balance after this perturbation. So in our study, we included a total of 82 older adults, of which 39 in the PBT group. In the table, you can see that both groups were very similar at baseline and that the median mini BESTA score at baseline was 23 points in both groups, which is already quite a high score if you consider that the maximum score is 28 points. The next graph will give you a visual overview of these baseline scores with the intervention group on the right side and in blue. And so after baseline, we started training for the PBT group. And we saw that perturbation recovery improved in each participant and that they were all able to progress to higher magnitude perturbations. The interviews revealed that participants enjoyed the training, were able to feel safe during training, felt more confident about their balance control, and that there was little anxiety, which was usually limited to the first training session. Now, in this next graph, the follow-up scores were added, and you can see that both groups showed improvements in balance control after training, which is for both groups on the right side, with a higher median value in the intervention group. And the intervention group is again in blue on the right side of the graph. However, we found no significant between group differences in balance control at follow-up. So there seems to be somewhat of a discrepancy between what we and the participants experienced during training and the results we measured with this outcome measure. And there are a few possible explanations for this, and I'll give you a few examples. The first one being that this may not have been the best outcome measure to capture training results. It's possible that this outcome was too broad and too different for training effects to transfer. Our long-term results on daily life falls will provide some insight if this is the case, but for future studies, we would recommend to combine clinical balance measures with more direct outcome measures. And it could also be that by including multiple perturbation types and directions to facilitate robust adaptations, the training dose of each individual perturbation type was too small to be effective. Future studies are still necessary to determine the effects of including multiple perturbation types on the dose-response relationship of PBT. So while we didn't find the results we expected, we think that it can still inform important questions for future studies. And if you have any questions, you can ask them now or email me later, and I will thank you all for listening.
Thank you.
Noelle is trying to round off, but Noelle, we can't hear you. Maybe you can give it one more go, or I'll take over in the last minute. Okay, thank you for your interesting talk. Are there any last questions from the audience? We have 40 seconds left before you will be sent back to the lobby. There's a question from Rick. Have you taken a look at differences of the individual mini best test items?
So far, I've looked at the differences in the four domains, so also the reactive balance domain, and we also see no between group differences in the separate domains, but not for really the individual tasks yet. So I can't really answer your question on that one.
Okay. Thank you all for attending, and have a very, very good day. Bye.
And maybe you can hear me now.
Yes, I can hear you, Noel.
Thanks all the speakers again for presenting nice talks.